Hello. I'm always surprised at the wonderful sound of this microphone. Welcome to the final seminar of the season. And today we're very fortunate to have with us Elvira Brattico, who's professor of neuroscience, music and aesthetics at Aarhus University, Denmark, where she's been since 2015. And also Aldo, professor of experimental psychology at the University of Bari, Aldo, Moro in Italy, since 2019. In 2015, she co-founded the famous Music in the Brain Center and is currently a PI of learning and executive board member there. Brattico has published more than 140 peer-reviewed papers in various areas of empirical aesthetics and neuroaesthetics of music, is a member of the editorial board of the journals Frontier Psychology, Psychomusicology, Applied Sciences, Plus One, to name some, and she has recently co-edited a special issue for the journal Frontiers in Psychology, as well as books for Routledge and Wiley. Today she's going to be giving a paper entitled Making Sense of Complex Music, Insights from Neurophysiology. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Professor Elvira Brattico.
And you hear me?
Yes.
Nice.
Okay.
So I think you can hear me pretty well. So good afternoon, I'll start again. Many thanks for having me here. This is really my first time in Oslo. and so I'll be really brief, so I'll leave already tomorrow early morning, but I'm really happy to be here and visit RITMO especially. So I'll talk about this topic, which sounds almost like semiotics, but I'll give operational definition from the point of view of neurophysiology later on. So the title is Making Sense of Complex Music. I wrote music in general here because, of course, what I'm going to say will work as well as for any kind of music. And for this talk, I will present results of studies conducted together with all these wonderful colleagues, especially PhD students and postdocs at the Center for Music in the Brain. And then there are other professors' spaces here, some of them you know, like Peter Wust and Anders Forman, PhD student of mine, Gemma Rubio, Gemma Fernandez Rubio. And I think that the talk will be of interest, or I hope it will be of interest, to also to those of you who study rhythm, even if here the main focus will be melody or pitch and melody processing, because I'll provide some findings that are, I think, important for knowledge about neuroscience, but also methodological advances of how we can study music in a way that is most ecologically valid possible. So going out of the very controlled type of paradigms that are typically used towards what real music.
And I think that this is something that should interest all of us.
And of course, the main framework is the predictive coding theory for music, which has been proposed by Carl Friston first, and then adapted for music, especially by Peter Wust and colleagues. But we used it. that this is something that we need to solve. This we need to understand how these memory-based predictions occur in the brain, especially when we have the stimuli from the environment that that are always extremely complex. And from the predicting coding theory adapted to music, we know that the memory-related brain areas give a top-down influence on the lower-level sensory areas because they bias the processing of any stimulation, low-level stimulation, by providing predictions based on learning and based on the prior experience of music and sounds. And the minimization of the prediction error is what we continuously do in music when we perceive, when we produce music, and also when we have emotions to music. And this prediction error minimization works continuously and reiteratively, repeatedly while learning. So we always learn how to update our model so that we are better in doing this prediction errors minimization. And one signal that we use for measuring all these processes is the mismatch negativity, which was first discovered in the late 70s by Risto Natanen in Helsinki, who was my PhD supervisor. And this is really an interesting signal because it's very reliable and easy to produce in the brain, and it's been localized particularly in the auditory cortex and also in frontoparietal areas. But interesting, depending on what kind of predictions and what kind of errors the brain is computing. So we have used this signal pretty much, and I will show you some of the findings related to mismatch negativity and related to the hierarchy of the processes that mismatch negativity is indexing. So, but before going there, I should say I anticipated say something about what it means for us to make sense of music. So we know that in music, sounds follow each other in time, and they have no special meaning when they are taken in isolation, so they don't represent anything. But when they are together and they have, for example, they form a melody or a motif, then they become something else. They become an object that can be transposed, that can be changed, and that is recognizable, as the Gestalt psychologists already noticed a long time ago. So the sounds that are isolated might not mean anything. They don't mean anything really. When they are integrated and they become a melody, they acquire novel meanings that would not be carried by the single sounds alone. So when we study how this kind of meanings come out of brain processes, then we have to look at different levels of in the hierarchy of melody processing. And a very nice classification of these hierarchies of processes has been proposed by Stanislav Dehaene and colleagues in 2015. So he characterized the different ways of producing this kind of memory-based predictions of sequences of sounds, such as a melody, but this can be applied also to speech, actually. And originally, he was referring to speech in particular. So the first level is the simple transition from one item to the other, so when we expect a sound after another one. The second level is chunking, so integrating the sounds, putting them together in some sort of pattern. And the third level is the knowledge of which item, ordinal knowledge of which item would come first. So to sort of temporarily organizing the sounds. And then the first level is actually abstracting the regularities, so looking at regularities in the sounds, and that's something that we do when we think about melodies and we transpose them over different tonalities, for example. And then finally is actually the level of the rules, so understanding what kind of rules are in these sounds and processing those rules. So when we process melodies and when we form memory-based predictions of them, we sort of go through all these levels of processing, and all these levels of processing have been sort of studied in the brain using different measures, different brain responses, and I will show you some of these results that we obtain in our lab. And most of these studies, actually, as I mentioned in the beginning, have used very simplified control stimulation, and sometimes something that doesn't really resemble much even a melody or a melodic motif, but it is more at the level of the first level, the transition from one note to the other, or maybe the second or third level, but they don't really go to the up to the fifth level very much. So most of the studies are actually related to control stimuli, and they don't look at all the different aspects that are related to making sense of complex sounds. And indeed, music is something else, it's much more complex. So we need to go up from the first level to the fifth if we want to understand really how predictions are formed in the brain and how memories of melodies are formed in the brain. So phenomenologically, making sense of real music does not correspond to listening to repeated isolated sounds. So it has to be much more complex, and it has to cover all the, as I mentioned, all the five levels as classified by Stanislav Hen. Yeah, and it's another problem of having only repeated sounds is that not only we miss the third, fourth, and maybe fifth level, so we don't really understand how melodies are integrated and how we get really something, how we make sense of complex music and so on. But we also are sort of making an experience that is not really a musical experience. So we repeat the same sounds, and this is something that is not really a music. It's a little bit like in the Groundhog Day, the movie, where the protagonist is waking up in the same day all over and over again. And of course, repeating this experience changes the emotions in the experience and changes really the meaning of it. So I show you just for fun. Then put your little hand in mine. There ain't no yellow mountain we can't climb. I don't know if you have watched this movie. Yeah. The music is by Cher and the husband. Very nice song.
Don't forget your booties, because it's cold out there.
It's cold out there every day. What is
this, Miami? Yeah, this first time he wakes up, and then there's another. The second time he wakes up in the same day, so he's a bit puzzled. He's just wondering what is going on.
So it's going, boys. You're playing yesterday's tape.
Hammers!
At the end, it becomes really angry. I jump.
Yes!
So this is what might happen to our participants when we repeat the same sounds as we have done, and I am guilty of that, I admit. When we the same isolated sounds with some little changes in them, or even the same patterns with some tiny changes in them. But I mean, definitely this is not really what is listening to music as a phenomenological experience. So we have to go a bit beyond that. Or very much beyond that. So, but in order to do that, we need to overcome the limitations of music neuroscience and of our, you know, devices, what we use to measure the brain responses. And first of all, we have to work on better simulation paradigms, so not the repeated beeps or bops, but something that resembles music. And we have to also implement new analysis methods that allow to extract the brain responses and you know, isolate them from complex sounds and also control for all the possible confounding variables. And then we also have to do studies that are investigating not just sensory processing, something that is just related to the, you know, transition or integration in which auditory cortex can well do alone without the rest of the brain, but processes that are more complex, that are more cognitive, that are often sort of neglected by much of the neurophysiological research, at least. So we should go towards what is called ecological validity, so to make our findings valid in the real world, so to the real experience of listening to the real music, to the music that people like to listen to. And we have been inspired to move towards what are called naturalistic paradigms, which are actually very ancient in experimental psychology. They are back to the early 1900s, the naturalistic approaches. For example, Frederick Bartlett in memory research started this kind of change of direction. But we in cognitive neuroscience, we have been inspired specifically by studies like this one by Yuri Hasson, published in Science 2004 already, where the investigation of the visual scene has been done not by just showing dots and lines or simplified visual patterns or colors, but by showing movies and by proposing different ways of analyzing fMRI data, such as intersubject correlation. And in music neuroscience, this kind of trend seems to have grown to some attention, such that Marie-Thérèse Vaniemi just published this year a short review in Trends in Neurosciences, where she presents this kind of naturalistic direction. So, yeah, it's an opinion paper, The Neuroscience of Music Towards Ecological Validity. So it's getting a momentum, so to speak. So we should go bolder with this kind of approach. So let's look at what we have done in terms of developing simulation paradigms. So first of all, with Peter Wust, we have introduced into the MMN research, the so-called multi-feature paradigm, where sounds are not just isolated or in patterns, but they sound like accompaniment, like an Alberti bass. So they resemble a little bit more some sort of music. Although this is very, very simplified. So with the PhD student David Quiroga Martinez, we have introduced another more melodic version of this Alberti bass, which sounds a bit better, although it's not yet music. So let's see the difference. So this is the original version with some errors inserted every third note about. And it has a very low entropy, which is Shannon entropy, which is a measure of uncertainty. So we know very well what kind of sounds are coming next, because it's always ta 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 ta, with some errors in between. So. So this is a slightly improved melodic version of it. So again, with some acoustic sensory level errors inserted once in a while. And so it's a bit higher entropy here. So we are a little bit more uncertain of what is coming next. And behaviorally, in this study by David in 2019, behaviorally, when taking several versions of these melodies, which are have an increased entropy, we can see that the certainty, the confidence of responding, whether there is an error or not, and the accuracy also in detecting these errors decreases as much as the entropy increases. So. And here is the representation of this also with this different levels of melodies. So Alberti bass, then a bit more regular melody, and then narrow melodies, random melodies, and wide melodies. So the this is a D prime. So the accuracy is decreasing in relation with the context, the complexity and the entropy of the context. And actually, even when you look at the brain responses, also the MMN, especially to the mistuning, so to the pitch error, becomes smaller the more there is the context is characterized by high entropy, which means that there is less precision in the model that we use for predicting what comes next, and less certainty as compared to the Alberti bass context. Oh, here it is actually. Yes, so for stimulus environments of low to medium uncertainty, model precisions affects prediction error minimization, but especially for the features that are, relevant to the model. In this case, the model is that of the melody of pitch melody. So the pitch errors are the ones that are most affected, and so which shows the modulation in the MMN response. And in music experts and non-musicians, this has also been studied. So this is a next paper published by David in Neuroimaging 2020. And there were 26 musicians, music experts, and 24 non-experts. And here we also see that there are larger MMN responses in the musicians as compared to the non-musicians, but especially to the pitch and also the slight errors. So again, to the features, the feature errors, which are most important for the model. So so they are the most wrong compared to the model that is used to predict these melodies. And the differences between non-musicians and musicians is showed in this B, in the lower part with the inflated brains, and it's located in the superior temporal gyrus bilaterally. Yeah, I go a bit farther here. There are some repetitions here. Sorry. But we also have developed another paradigm, which is called Mus-Melo. So this was developed actually in Helsinki by Minna Huotilainen and Mari Tervaniemi. And this is a little bit more complex than just a single melody, because it contains also some chords. And it is also interesting paradigm because it allows to go up to study the cognitive rules that are inside, because we have what are called sensory deviance, so very acoustic errors, and then we also have more cognitive deviance, so something that some errors that require that you have understood what kind of tonality or rhythm is in these melodies. And so we have done a study with, published last year in Neuroimage, where we looked at the MAG responses to all these kind of deviance, like six types of deviance. And we have 104 participants, with some of them have up to 7 years of music training. So they were also divided according to their musical expertise. So let's see what happens. As we saw earlier, the sensory prediction at the level of auditory cortex, or does it go beyond the auditory cortex when we look at the cognitive? And indeed, the results show when we reconstructed the neural responses, the MMN neural responses with beamforming as inverse model, then we saw that there are differences between the more acoustic sensory level deviance, so the lower levels of predictions, up to the more cognitive levels of predictions, such as melody modulation or rhythm modulation or even the transposition. And so that when we see this kind of cognitive deviance, then we move out of the auditory cortex. We have activity also in the frontal area, cingulate cortex, and also orbital frontal areas. And so you see, there are all these areas here, especially some motor cingulate area. The orbital frontal is not very well visible here, but the sensory deviance, as you see in the blue, they are actually much more localized in auditory areas and on the right side, whereas there is more frontal in the for cognitive deviance, more frontal activity for the MMN. And importantly, when we look at the expertise, so when we study how the experts differ from non-experts, then we see that there are even more frontal activations for musicians in cingulate areas and inferior frontal gyri, and also in supplementary motor areas with the more years of training there were in the participants. But so far we have looked at music that is tonal, so it follows rules that with which we are very familiar. But there is a very interesting case of style of music that where all these rules are demolished, they don't exist anymore. So I just have an example, I think it's Yeah, or Shardino. Now you have some sort of predictions because you see the scores. But otherwise, you might say that, yeah, what you can predict is that the sounds will be unpredictable or that there will be some sort of very fast transitions, but you never know when it will stop suddenly and when there will be some other kind of sounds coming. It is a... This kind of music, new music, experimental music, doesn't follow the rules of tonality or rhythm that we are most familiar with. And it is actually a very interesting style to study from our perspective because it can model the situation when we can't predict. So in life, we try to predict everything, but in fact, with a complex simulation, often we are facing things which are new and that are hard to predict, where uncertainty prevails. So it's interesting to study also this kind of music, first of all, because it exists and there are aficionados. There is a restrict group of people who like it a lot. And also, so it has a musicological, status and worth of studying, but also because it is interesting to study what is called exploratory behavior. As we have written in a review published last year. So with tonal melodies, the salience of unexpected events and also the MMN, that we can measure out of the errors are modulated by the certainty and the precision of the predictions as we have seen, and depending on the type of errors we can see the activity that is localized mainly auditory cortices or that it spreads to the frontal areas up to the cingulate infrafrontal gyri and supplementary motor areas or motor cortex. But with the tonal music, there are no such tonal hierarchies. Actually, in the second VNS school, which we have studied with Iris Menke, that is actually the first starting point that all the sounds should be equal, so there shouldn't be a hierarchy among sounds. And so we have a type of environment where the uncertainty is highest and there is the lowest level of prediction. So we have this strong predictive models and tonal stability with Western tonal music, but weak predictive models and with atonal stability of the atonal new music. So we, with Iris Menke, we tried to study the MMN responses when the errors, of acoustic errors again, were inserted in a melodic context that is atonal. So built from the, actually from 12 note series. So we had these two kinds of melodies. One was fully tonal, which is similar to the ones by David Quiroga that I showed earlier, and then another one which is fully atonal. And then there are these mistuning, intensity changes, timbre changes, location changes inserted in each of these contexts. And so in agreement with the previous study by David Quiroga, and others 2019, we found MMM responses to all the errors in the tonal melodies. But we didn't find a clear effect of the context. So that you see the in blue tonal and in the in red the tonal context and in blue the atonal context, and there are no significant differences that are visible here. So it seems that in this case, when the context is completely uncertain and different, then the precision of the error calculation for this low-level acoustic features is not really changed. So this suggests that the tonal uncertainty, the sheer tonal uncertainty, so the uncertainty of the model does not influence the degree to which deviance are processed at the low-level stages, so the low-level hierarchy of the memory-based predictions as reflected by MMM. So in contrast to the MMM results, the behavior actually shows differences, because in the tonal context, participants responded with much more certainty and they were more accurate as compared to the atonal context, as you see here. And the confidence also is much lower in this. So the generation of predictive models for sounds is strongly embedded on higher processing levels in the presence of this very uncertain, weird environments, like melodies. Whereas the sensory models are still quite strong, so they are indexed by the auditory cortex MMM responses, which were, however, not affected by the lack of the tonal hierarchies in the atonal melodies. So we can see here from this study that we have sort of reached the limits of our paradigms also of what we are seeing with MMM to these very acoustic errors. So we are not really seeing any cognitive computation here, because we are indexing auditory cortex type of response. So we have done instead another approach. So we adopted another approach to look at more cognitive processes that indeed occur when we listen to music. And we borrowed from visual and verbal memory research what is called the old new paradigm. So it's very well known. I'm checking the time. It's very well known especially in visual memory research for episodic memory. But we sort of adapted it to music and to MEG in particular. So we have conducted studies where, we have done this, as I mentioned, this old new paradigm, which includes two phases. The first phase is the study phase, which is called also encoding phase, where you are expose participants to some stimuli, in our case to music, and it was actually prelude. We used actually a prelude from the first volume of the Well-Tempered Clavier by Johann Sebastian Bach. We use actually the prelude in C major and C minor. And then we, in the second phase, we took some 40 excerpts, 40 motifs from the prelude, and then we took another 40, which were variations of them, which were sort of invented by, composed by us, but were matched in all the complexity, entropy, acoustic levels. And we exposed these 40 plus 40 motifs to the participants and asked them to recognize if they heard them before or if they were new. So that's why they had to say if it's old or new. So we did this with 71 participants in the study that we published last year in communications biology. And the participants also went to MRI because then we used the individual MRI images to reconstruct the neural responses. And we had two conditions because we had this one condition with the prelude. Yeah, we used here the C major in particular. We focused on the C major prelude. But I have some example here, sorry. So it sounded like this. Yeah, of course, it's like a one voice rendition, a MIDI rendition. So it is still not exactly how it should sound, but almost real music. And then, so this was for the encoding phase, they listened actually four times to the prelude. And then for the old new recognition task, they listened to this kind of excerpts. Yeah, this is very, very recognizable, or this one. So they are either old or new excerpts. So the participant had to recognize which were heard already or which not. And then we had another condition which was actually detonalized version of the Bach prelude. So all the tonal hierarchies were taken out and it sounded like this. People might say that it's even, well, I don't know. I don't say that it's nicer. I don't think anybody can say that it's nicer. It's a masterpiece. Yeah, we of course always choose music that we love ourselves. That's but so I'm partial for this, but it's interesting, anyways. So these are the this is what we heard. So it's old. Yeah, also this one, but these are new. Okay, so as I mentioned, this kind of old new paradigm allows to study memory recognition processes, so something that goes beyond the sensory level of encoding. And the results are along what we expect, so that there are much more errors in the recognition for the atonal excerpts as compared to the major, and also in terms of reaction times that they are slower. So this goes along with what we know from the literature and from previous studies. But let's look at the brain, if I can. Yes. So we have actually studied the two frequency ranges where the most of the activity was visible. So from 0.1 to 1 hertz and 2 to 8 hertz. And also looking at the responses to each of the notes of the excerpt of the melodic motif in the old new task, and comparing the, here you have in red the tonal recognition process and the atonal recognition for each of the sort of the notes in the motifs. And for the tonal, you see again is actually quite clear, especially in the well, in both frequency ranges, that there are more frontal and even parietal activities, and then hippocampal activities in for the tonal recognition, whereas the activities for the atonal are smaller, and for the lower frequency range, mainly confined to auditory areas. So there are these qualitative differences depending on the complexity of the stimuli to be memorized and recognized. So there is the behavioral recognition that is superior for tonal sequences is actually reflected in the brain in hippocampal and cingulate activations, whereas the recognition of tonal sequences was actually mainly in confined to an auditory network. So these findings actually extend to music memory recognition and to MAG, what we have seen before with fMRI, also with previous study of mine by another former PhD student, Burunat, Ibaya Burunat in Ivascula, which examining how and where musical sounds are stored and consolidated in the brain, and which found hippocampal, frontal, and basal ganglia activity. So here we have found this kind of activity, as you see here. So hippocampal and frontal and cingulate, even with the MAG, and this is a new finding, novel finding, which is nicely being already reviewed. Well, not exactly this study, but the other one, which I showed later, by recent review by Billig and colleagues, published in Progress in Neurobiology last year, which is termed the hearing hippocampus. It's really excellent review if you haven't seen it yet, because it covers all what is known about audition and hippocampal activity, including memory, but not only memory. So, what we know, however, so far is about neural activity during memory-based predictions or predictive processes, but we haven't looked at any cognitivity findings yet. And what we know from functional cognitivity for memory formation or for sounds actually relies on other domains, on speech or visual domain, or on animal models, including studies conducted here by Alejandro, I think. And there are very few studies with fMRI and free listening paradigm done by me and colleagues in Uvascula, looking at functional connectivity during memory formation for music. So we actually have done a study where we also used the naturalistic free listening paradigm, but with MAG, and this is actually the study that comes before the previous one. So where we have the we focus on the encoding part of the old new paradigm, and we have 68 participants that listened to the C minor prelude, not to the C major, again from the first volume of the Well-Tempered Clavier. And here this is just a quick representation of how the brain activity, it's actually the amplitude modulations of the envelope that is actually reconstructed with beamforming, and then there are all the connectivity is extracted by taking the instantaneous instantaneous phase of the pairwise voxels. And note by note, so looking at what happens after encoding each sound while listening. And these are, the results, of course, focus on M1 component because it's the connectivity analyzed for each neural response to each sound, which is the N1, the highest one. But looking at the connectivity, so during sound encoding, when the participants were actually asked to memorize the sounds, so this is the, as I mentioned earlier, this is the first part of the old new paradigm, so the encoding part. And what we found here is that, of course, the auditory areas were active and connected, but we obtained connections within the first 1 to 6 milliseconds from the auditory areas to the also other areas of higher order association regions, including insula, the superior temporal pole, hippocampus, and the cingulate cortex. And actually, especially the insula and superior temporal lobe were also very central, but the connections, they are visible in the red over there, from insula to hippocampus and the cingulate. They are visible, such as Bach Prelude in C minor, which is one of the most beautiful pieces. Again, it's my personal choice of with the PhD students. We both love this piece. But anyway, it's also very excellent for MAG research because it's isochronous and easy to turn into a simulation. So anyway, we know that when we try to make sense of this wonderful music, we definitely need, as this data show us, that we definitely need several brain structures connecting and working together for integrating and storing information carried by sounds. And so we saw even cortical hippocampal interactions. And yeah, we have other findings don't have time now to present you, but with also the old new task with the C minor, confirming what I showed earlier with the previous study with Etona music as well. And we know also about all the studies with on functional connectivity with hippocampal regions, superior in musicians over non-musicians. So everything seems to merge into the same picture. And so these findings overall, what I presented so far, support the hippocampal role for episodic memory for musical sounds. But they also maybe don't support much the standard consolidation theory, the traditional one about hippocampal memory, because according to this theory, the hippocampus is less involved the more the traces are consolidated. Well, we don't know yet, actually, but I think that this data might support, together with also the fMRI data, the multiple trace theory instead, which states that each time a memory engram is recalled, encoding occurs again and again in hippocampus, along with the context when this is recalled, like we do when we listen to a Bach prelude that we know already. So we actually use the hippocampus all over again. In fact, some of these people were familiar with the music. I didn't mention you. So the hippocampus keeps being involved according to the multiple trace theory, either in indexing or reconstructing the distributed cortical engrams that are all over the cortex, or in maintaining those. But we need to do more studies to actually explain better or to provide further support for the multiple trace theory. And now it starts a whole new whole new section, which I think that I've talked a lot, but I can just mention that we are also working on how to extract cortical responses when listening to whole musical polyphonic pieces, so not just one voice MIDI version of Bach preludes, but also whole musical pieces. And we use the MIRT toolbox for that, developed by Olivier, who is here, and Petit Ovenen. And we have been able to, following the first study where I also participated by Poikonen and others in 2003, we have been able to obtain evoked responses P1 and 1 and P2 from the largest changes in the music, which we extracted with the MIRT toolbox. And yeah, actually, this is a visualization. I've been told that not everybody knows this, I think. Some of you definitely know. But this is a visualization of how, for example, brightness parameter is extracted with the MIRT toolbox based on the spectrum of the compressed sound. And this is for the rhythm. The bass guide extracted from the envelope modulation. Okay, now you see that it grows when the pass becomes very obvious. And then here. And then this is how the key clarity is computed based on the extraction of the pitch chroma from the real from the wave file. So sorry for interrupting Addio Sonnino like that by Piazzolla. So we proceeded with these studies originated in Helsinki by Hanna Poikonen and colleagues. With Nils Haumann in Aarhus, and we managed again to obtain brain responses to the clearest changes in the music. So you see like here that when there are clear, you know, abrupt changes in the feature, for example in brightness, there are also some P1 and 1 responses. Yeah, there is no time to go into much details. I just, we have published this in 2021 in Brain Research, how we managed to standardize the way the feature changes were extracted, because we had to look also at the previous time when the features were sort of stable, and then computing when they changes, they changed in a very clear way, salient way. And we made this kind of extraction automatic. So we basically identified a measure called the magnitude of rapid increase, which was an improvement as compared to the previous study by Poikonen and colleagues, where this magnitude was tuned manually for each song. So it was not very, very automatic way before. So, and we obtained, again, both with the MEG and with the MEG, this evoked responses in the brain, and we even managed to reconstruct the sources in the auditory cortex for the very basic, for example, amplitude changes. So this is very nice, I think, implementation, because it shows that we can just play music to participants and then get brain responses out of that very, you know, very ecological listening situation. Yeah, I skipped this, but we just got accepted a study where we applied the same kind of approach with older people versus younger people. And we are also implementing a novel way to study brain responses to real music by automatically detecting the sound onset. And by looking at the way actually the brain is able to entrain to the sort of repetitive beat or the some sort of periodicity, temporal periodicity in the music. So we can see whether by playing a real music we can obtain with MEG the auditory steady state response. So how we can see the phase locking in the brain signal with some periodicity in the sounds. I don't go into details. So this is actually, this is a piece by Dream Theater, Simon Consciousness. And this is what we managed. This is very new and it's not yet published. But you can see on the left the onsets calculated for each sound. This is not really locked now, just tricked. You can see that there is a periodicity in the activation in the this superior temporal gyri and the right ventral premotor cortex. So there is some sort of auditory steady state response. Both in the auditory cortex and the motor areas. I stop here. So just to conclude, so this was very, very new, what I showed you before, and we will talk about this with Olivier later in the afternoon about this study more in details. Just to conclude, so I've talked about different ways to improve our ecological validity and finding more knowledge about how we make sense of real complex music. So we have implemented new paradigms from the multi-feature ones to the that are adaptive even to atonal music to the free listening, totally naturalistic paradigms that are go from the one voice MIDI melodies to the real wave pieces. And we have also implemented MAG and EEG analysis so that we can extract evoked responses, even perhaps auditory steady state potential from real music, and also functional connectivity analysis with MAG and at a very millisecond temporal resolution. So to follow really all the different steps of information processing and predictions in the brain. And then we also have implemented the different levels of the processes from the first to the fifth level as in the classification by the hand, and also going from the short term level of memory-based prediction to maybe to longer term level to episodic memory. And we showed that with conscious recognition and prediction, we need recruitment of frontal and hippocampal region and also interaction between auditory and prefrontal and hippocampal areas of the brain. And we don't know yet if this kind of processes occur in experts of atonal music, because we have seen so far tonal music experts, but that's the next step, what we will do with Iris Menke, who has already collected data in Frankfurt with contemporary experimental music experts. And we will see if hippocampal prefrontal cortex connections suddenly occur in them as well. Okay, that's all. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much. We now have time for some questions or comments or thoughts. I can begin while everyone else... Oh, Finn can beat me to it. Yes, that's fine.
There's a light here. I stay here because there's a light in my face. Yeah.
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk and lovely experiments. One of the fun things of introducing complex music is having to leave a little bit open, more open the response of the listeners. And as you were presenting your studies with the prelude in C major, I can't help but think of the Gounod Ave Maria. It's a very common thing to hear those two things together. And so in those situations, if people know the piece, you know, they may be adding a line in their minds to what is happening. How do you propose controlling for those kinds of additions in your participants if they're evoking the rest of the music or another piece of the music along with what you're playing? Are you instructing people to not imagine more than what they hear, or is that something you think that maybe be kind of outside given the way that you're focusing in on this MEG data? Anyway, this is a big question, but it comes to mind with your very specific examples.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's a very important question. I mean, we haven't controlled too much in this particular study, except for asking about how familiar they were with this, with the two preludes, and whether they were pianists or any other musicians who actually played them. Because in fact, we wanted to have groups of participants that played, so they knew really, had a very radical memory, also motoric memory of the piece, and others who were familiar but not with the motoric memory and so on. At the end, the study turned out differently, so we didn't focus anymore on that, but that was the only way to control, so just the familiarity and expertise in instrument. But in another study that the PhD student Gemma Fernandez Rubio is doing, we changed a bit the approach. So we are still using the old new paradigm with them, but we actually ask participants either to encode and memorize or to just listen without trying to memorize. So and there we, and then at the end we also ask about what kind of strategy they used for memorizing. So we hope that it will be a bit more controlled in that way. Although it's still sort of introspection, it's not so easy because you have to just trust what they say. But then the brain is actually quite transparent, because if we believe our data as we do, because now we have developed quite an expertise, especially the younger guys in analyzing this stuff, so we can see really how much the different parts of the brain are involved. And then we shouldn't do reverse inference, but I often have had the case in my past that when there was something weird in the brain, then there was something wrong in the data or something funky happened. And so I do believe in the brain responses. Just as a shortcut, yeah.
I think I'll follow with my question now. So it relates somehow to the idea of control, but I'm wearing my musicological hat. I apologize for that, or maybe I don't. But it has to do with a question of the relationship between the melody and harmony. And as you label something atonal, To some extent, I'm just curious about that because how do you so for these very short snippets of Bach that you then you pointed out you had detonalized, which made more sense, right? Mm-hmm. Because when you hear them out of context, or if you don't have enough time in the stimulus to get a sense of a tonal center, then rather than checking for whether there's a perception of atonality, couldn't it equally be a sense that there's a perception of chromaticism? So how might you control for, so labeling it atonal maybe rather than even sometimes random, so depending on the context. So I'm wondering, about the label atonal.
Yes, I mean, this was at the end, it was a proxy for atonality, but I said purposively that they are detonalized rather than built from scratch as atonal music, which is something else. If we think about what is musicologically, what is atonal music, is not what we did there. So that was just transposing up and down by one semitone, the original prelude, to match acoustically and in the contour. But it's not built based on a 12-tone series or whatever other surrealism or dodecaphony has actually defined historically as atonal music. So So it's a first type of study with that. The other one, the one where we built the multi-featured melody in an atonal way, that was more musicological way, because that was done starting from the 12 note series and removing any tonal hierarchy over there. So it was a bit better musicologically, but it's not yet the real atonal music. We do have a study, Iris Menken in Max Planck in Frankfurt has collected all the data with the contemporary classical musicians and the romantic classical musician, or the normal classical musicians, and using excerpts from the second Viennese school musical pieces, so Schoenberg, Berg, all this, up to Stockhausen, I think. And so there we have a real atonal music as a simulation. But we are still, meeting and thinking how to analyze that because it is quite challenging.
Thank you.
So it's coming up in a couple of years from now, I think.
Thank you so much. Just a matter of teasing apart the different dimensions that go into the concepts, atonality, complex, etc., because it could be very interesting to try to explore this rather large territory with, let's say, modal music, take music of Messiaen, which is quite complex when it comes to pitches, but you can still have a very clear, or variably at least clear, sense of tonality in it. So, fortunately now with the MIDI instruments, actually we have been promised here a MIDI grand piano, so Alexander here should deliver, which could make those kinds of experiments much more easy, feasible to do. You could have very good performances where you can, let's say, change the Bach prelude to something completely different. But more precisely, do you have any idea of how to quantize, let's say, dissonance or complexity in music? Because you played the C minor prelude, which is much more complex than the C major prelude. You have more dissonance, for one thing.
Yeah.
So whether you have any reflections on that could be interesting to hear.
Yeah. Thank you so much. And I remember you from when I was a student in summer school in, where was it, Jyväskylä or Helsinki?
And I tried to make additive synthesis examples for you.
So, I think that Yeah, in terms of technological tools, we do have them. And in fact, in the study I mentioned with the Max Planck, there was a pianist. Well, Max Planck resources are quite exceptional. So they hired a famous, famous pianist for playing our stimuli. So it was really wonderful. It's actually a professor in the US, internationally famous performer. And we decided what he had to play. And so we chose romantic pieces and sort of matched, more or less matched contemporary 801s. And then he played on the grand MIDI grand piano. So, and then we got the wave recordings, but also the MIDI. So that's the data set with the MAG responses in experts of classical music and contemporary music as well. So it's really wonderful data set that we are really gonna finally analyzing soon. So technically, it's possible having all these wonderful resources, and that's, I do like a lot Messiaen's music, so I would really love to have, again, as a sort of a subjective criteria how to choose the stimulation, to have him there. But in terms of the parameters to quantify dissonance and complexity, We sort of choose what is available in the literature from information theory field, like Marcus Pierce has developed this idiom model, which however works only for single melodies, and it has some limits because you have to train the model with a corpus, and it's very much relating on the corpus that you choose for the training. So it's a statistical probabilistic model of expectations, and it's only, as I said, only one line, so it's not really applicable for the real music. But then you can use some other what is in a mere toolbox, for example, in the some of the periodicity measures, so that you can look at measures of how different acoustic structures are recurrent, and then with that you can measure also roughness or some of the acoustic levels of dissonance. But the musical dissonance is a bit more complicated, I guess, to measure. And there are also other. I met one researcher from UK, and I think he works between Oxford and London, Fernando Rosas, who has developed another measure for studying the symmetry or asymmetry and within chords in Bach chorales. I don't know yet if that can be applied to this kind of more complex music. I think that the conclusion to the question, sorry, just thinking aloud, is that we need to use what is available in the literature and look around, not just the colleague or the thing that we know or that everybody uses, but really explore what exists. Also reach out to music information retrieval, information theory, physics, or reach out to these other measures. But also don't forget, we shouldn't forget musicology, the musicologists, the analysis that the experts in musicology can do with pitch class theory or all the theories that are developed. And so theory-based, I think that the best would be to use theory-based combined with computational-based descriptions, as we have done in some studies with Nils Haumann, actually, and how to identify the the sounds that are salient according to a musicological sense. Why they should actually evoke those kind of responses. So to combine interdisciplinary knowledge from different fields. That's a long answer, sorry.
No. Thank you for a very interesting talk. A lot of fantastic stuff. I'm tempted to start with a comment on complexity, because that's, of course, a very tricky. It's a complex thing, especially because it's also a cultural thing. So what's complex, if you look at experience, can vary quite a lot. And I think there's a certain bias also in the musicological discussions about complexity that's worth taking into account. But my question was rather about the study with the Bach prelude in C major, because I just noticed that when you introduced the new excerpts, it seems that not only the configuration of notes or pitches were changed, but also the contour.
Yeah,
because the Bach prelude is a very kind of all the things are going upwards. I'm not sure if it's a problem, but I just wanted to ask if you've thought about it.
No, actually, I think that the examples have been chosen a bit poorly by my students, because I know that they actually are matched.
Okay.
They are matched in terms of contour and all the acoustic low-level aspects. So in terms of information content, because they have applied idiom model to make sure that they are sort of comparable in the context. Yeah.
Mm. No, because of course melody is also about contour, not only combinations of pitches. So it could still be, part of that. But thanks.
Yeah.
Great. We have a question down here.
Hi, thanks for the awesome talk. Quick question about the last part, more practical. You elicit the auditory steady state response by the natural by the intrinsic amplitude modulations in the music, or do you modify modulating the envelope?
No, it's just out of the real music listening.
It's just the music.
No, just that. Of course, we don't know if it's like a sort of induced, a modulation of the induced brain oscillations, or if it's just exogenous, which we think is the latter one. But still, it's auditory steady state. We know that it's just the music listening is able to produce this kind of phase-locked brain activity in those two parts,
Okay, thank you.
Which I think is a very fantastic way, because we don't need to make very boring or just tapping tasks, just listen or do things in a natural way.
Also related to that study, on that slide, there was something about the beat that is not present in the acoustic stimuli. The beat frequency was not immediately present in the intensity or spectral changes in the audio. It says on the right. So does it mean that is less likely that this is caused by evoked responses to the stimuli? Is that?
Yeah, no, it's rather the other way around. So that the beat, so this is a sort of not, it's a grouping of sound of the onsets. So the beat is not acoustically very clear, whereas in the other one you can hear that it's every note sort of da, 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 da. So you can hear that there is the beat also in the sound.
Yeah.
Here it's more like an abstraction of the beat, so it's not present, not audible.
Yeah, so it's not in the acoustic features.
Yeah.
So what we see in
but
the MEG might be more
it
induced,
might be.
More
might be.
Okay. I don't.
Oh, this is just the first attempt of this. We are planning to do a study where we actually will ask participants to do the tapping, so to make sure that they actually listen to the so that there is a real rhythmic entrainment to that frequency. Because now we are sort of inferring that there is some also rhythmic entrainment, but we can't really say it yet because we don't have the behavioral data.
Yeah.
So we only have the neural data here. Mm-hmm. And of course we should, to make even more sure, we should do some other manipulations, so to slow it down, slow the music or speed it up, or or even better, to do some neuromodulation with some you know, direct current simulations to block the beat even better. That would be nice study.
It's still a really nice finding, also that it is in the premotor cortex.
It's really exciting.
That's super cool,
It's very new, but I wanted to show you because it's really, I like it.
Any further questions? No? Then I think we can end our session here. Thank you so much, Elvira, for such a wonderful finale to the seminar series this spring.
Thanks for inviting me. Thank you.